on the crack. Hip hop's version of Cat in the Hat. Gangsta Black and a patch on my back. Drum and a bass, two cats and a sax. Little bit of that and a little bit of this.
Alright, so I'm Matt, or Celestial Serpent, and today I'm going to give you a bit of a lesson on sacred geometry. Alright, so it's a pretty interesting subject. I've found myself obsessed with it. Alright, so that's me, Celestial Serpent. So sacred geometry is everywhere. It's in nature. That's how we recognize it. It's not something that man or woman has created. It's something that's naturally found in nature, and then we just saw it. Yep.
What is it?
Like, do you know what geometry is? Well, it's like mathematics. So it's in mathematics, there's these certain patterns that just, they're everywhere. They're in the human body. And hopefully in the course of this PowerPoint, I can show you what it is, because it's just everywhere. Any more questions before I jump right into it? All right, well, let's go in there. So you can really see it in here, these spiraling patterns in the pine cones and everything, the sunflower. So it's just nature's beauty, and it's amazing. So sacred geometry is something that also explains how creation begun. And they say in the Bible and in a lot of ancient texts that there was nothingness, there was this stillness and this darkness, and then all of a sudden life came out of nowhere. And sacred geometry is a way of explaining how this happens, how all came from nothingness. So we start like this, you know, this is nothingness. You know, it's quite hard to imagine or draw nothingness because it's nothingness. But if you imagine this is it. In order for consciousness or love or God or life to experience itself, it had to expand and create some parameters or some... If I use words that are too big for you, like, hit me up, because I want to explain this the best way I can, but I'm used to teaching adults, so it's this type of stuff. It's the first time I've tried to teach it to kids of your age. I reckon you'll get it, but just tell me if there's something you don't get. So the first thing that happens is that from the very center of life, consciousness expands and creates the circumference of a circle, which is now kind of its dimensions. It's like your skin, the outside of you.
Mm-hmm. Does it just it keeps going round and round and
then
bigger and then it just stops at the point?
Well, this is more theoretical. Like, it's not necessarily like scientific and its process, but this is how all life starts according to a lot of religious and occult understanding. So what happens after life or consciousness, and you've got to also understand that, like, when you look in your body, like, everything is really, it starts really simple, like as a single celled organism, and then things get more and more complex until we get beings like us, which are so complex when you look at our beings, but it all starts really simple. And nature's also a little bit more simple, so it's easy to see it in nature. So it happens like this, and then from the outermost part of its being, the circle replicates what it already does. So it knows how to make a circle. So what it does is it does the exact same thing, and you get the symbol known as the viscopisces. So this is a symbol that's been used for a long, long time. And within it, you can find the square root of 2 here. You can find the square root of 3 and the square root of 5. I'm not sure if you guys know what square roots are yet. But the point is, there's so much mathematics in this, and it's really amazing. And it's also got, these are some of the first numbers in the Fibonacci sequence, which we'll go over later. So, like, the Bible speaks of it in the form of Genesis, when it says, "Let there be light." This is the first stage, because this is the symbol of light. And you can also see that it's light from the shape of it. So this thing here, which is like the cosmic womb or the sacred feminine, from all life comes this. So the eyes are the same shape. You can see flames have it, even the galaxy, and the way that nature creates uses the symbol. And you also can see it in churches and in Christianity. It's very common to see these these type of shapes from which the Christ came from. So you see like Jesus inside of this sacred thing, and you can understand that this is where all life comes from. And it's also the shape of a vagina, of female reproductive organs. So it's everywhere. And you also find it in marketing, like a lot of brands, like you probably know Apple, and you'll find these shapes everywhere. And it's kind of like, you might not know it, but you know it deep inside of yourself, like in the subconscious mind, they say. I'm not sure if you, it might be a bit advanced again, but these symbols are everywhere anyway. And you also find it in the electromagnetic field of the earth. So everything has this geometry to it. And this is something called the torus, which we're going to get into later, because it's really amazing. It's like the three-dimensional version of this.
That's cool.
So if we go to over here, and we've got the Vesca Piscis, what you can do then, if you go to either one of these two points and do the same thing, you get this, you know, which is the Trinity. You'll see this symbol often used in Christianity again and other religions that talk about the threefold part of God. And then it just keeps on going until you've got the seven circles and what is known as the seed of life. So this pattern is just is something that's really, really amazing. You'll find it everywhere. And it's also kind of where the yin and yang comes from this as well. Can you see the yin and yang in there?
Oh, yeah.
And that's a symbol of balance. Like it's a very Eastern symbol, but it's a symbol of the masculine and the feminine, like the man and the woman, the dark and the light, and how that there needs to be a balance. So it's all about finding that balance within yourself as well. Now here we can also see that this type of pattern on the monatomic level, which means it's happening inside of us. This is how babies are made. This is how cells split. When a cell splits, it takes on this geometry. So it's not something that we've created again. This is something that we've come to understand is everywhere. Everywhere. And what's interesting, because it's everywhere, it leads us to understand something known as, I know it as fractality, or something that's the microcosm and the macrocosm. But in layman's terms, this means like what you see in the big picture is exactly the same as the small picture. And you can, like, if you look at the pentagram there, you can kind of understand that this is the big picture, and then within it, it's again and again and again and again and again. It goes on for infinity. So through mathematics, you can understand that all life is connected. Every atom communicates with each other, and life just goes on forever. And you can see it here in the hexagram as well. Hex coming from six. And when you take the seed of life and you add more circles and you think of it as this is the top, then you can start to understand this. So this or this is this pattern here called the torus, but you're looking at it as if you're looking down on it. So this is like the very center, and it kind of just keeps on going around and around and around. And this is like this is around our bodies right now. You can't see it, but all energy that has electromagnetism, it travels like in this pattern. So yeah, you can see it in the Earth's magnetic field. You can see it in like the galaxies, and even the way that the equator it's just everywhere. It really is everywhere, and the symbol phi, which is something that you'll come into in mathematics pretty soon if you haven't already. You can also see that this whole geometry, like where the symbol comes from, known as phi. Now, these are some images out of some books where you can kind of see this energy pattern revolving around a human, because we have this energy going around us at all times, and every atom has this energy field. There's a bit of nudity there. Don't worry about it. It's all natural. We all have bodies. So these are different forms of it. Like when you change the distance of the two circles, like on this one they're kind of touching like that, and it would look like this. And you can kind of see where it overlaps. But if you further out the circles or the spheres, you get like a donut shape. So the donut shape is the same thing. You kind of see how it just keeps on going round and round, and it's pretty interesting. And also, technology uses this. So all the technology we use, like transformers and things like that, they use this pattern because it's so effective. It's a really good way to transport electricity and to conduct electricity. And even space stations and rocket ships and all that, they're using this technology and this geometry. Yeah?
You look at that symbol there.
Yeah.
Why is it so important?
It's important because it can help you to understand how all life began and how life creates. And I'm only interested in this stuff because it helps me to understand how thoughts and emotions and everything works. And something that is known as metaphysics, which is the science of being. So it's all about being. And to me, this knowledge leads to all the secrets of being happy. So it's like a really practical thing. It might not seem like it at this point, but we'll get there. So yeah, this geometry is everywhere, and it's nature's beauty. And when you can see this mathematics in nature, like you start realizing that everything is a miracle. Every little plant, every little seed, it's like a miracle. Sorry, did you have a question? This one?
Yeah.
I think that's some type of broccoli, actually, but because there's so many different types of broccoli. The ones we buy from the supermarket are just one type, and there's like hundreds of them.
Yeah. That over there, that spiky thing.
That one's kind of like an I don't know if you, do you know aloe vera?
Yes.
It's kind of like an aloe vera, and this is a sunflower, and this is a pine cone. So if you look at nature, you'll start to notice this stuff, and fire is what I'm going to teach you next, because that is the key to understanding all this. Now fire is 1.618 to 1. So I'll just write that on the board. 1.618. So a way of understanding this is if this is 1, this is 1.618. And you can see it here in the square. So that is 1 and that's 1.618. And this is like a ratio that it comes from the Greek. The word phi is actually a letter in the alphabet. Yeah.
Why is the A bigger than B?
Why is the what?
Squares.
Why is it, sorry?
Squares.
Why is one bigger?
The squares bit longer. No, it's A, B, A.
Well, it's, what I'm kind of showing with this is that 1.618 is something that's, it's also in your body. So if you look at your fingers and you look at, it's all over your body. So right here, that is 1.618 to 1. So do you guys know ratios? Do you guys know ratios?
No.
So it's pretty much like if you look at 1.618, you'll just find this all over your body, like from where, I'll go to the next slide, because you can see that this thing is, it's not just something again that we've created, it's something that's everywhere. So when you look at fire, what you can create from fire is something called the Fibonacci sequence. So this number sequence is how nature grows. So this is all about nature, which used to be very sacred to our ancestors. So it starts with 0, which is the nothingness, and also that circle is where you get the sacred womb, or it's a symbol of the sacred feminine and pregnancy and birth. And then from the 0, you get the 1. And then, see, how this works is it uses its past to get the future number. So 1 and 0 is 1. 1 and 1 is 2. 2 and 1 is 3. 3 and 2 is 5. 5 and 3 is 8. And it just keeps on going forever and ever. Yeah?
We do stuff like that. Mass.
Mm-hmm.
So if we do these kind of triangles,
yeah.
With the other one, then it keeps going.
Yeah. Yeah, it's the same type of thing. It's just, it gives you an understanding of nature, because nature is very infinite. And you can also see it here, like, you can do it in a three-dimensional form as well. You can go zero, which you can't draw, one, another one, and then two, and three, and you can just go forever, but you'll find that if you connect these up, you start getting a spiral. Sorry, I didn't do a very good job of drawing that. But you can see it better here. So it's 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13. It just keeps on going. But it's so important because nature's doing this as well. Like, this is a beautiful shell. I think it's a nautilus shell. And you can just see in nature that this mathematics is there. Now, if you take this number sequence and you divide it by itself, so if you go 0 divided by 1, it's 0, 1 divided by 1 is 1, 2 divided by 1 is 2, 3 divided by 2 is 1.5, and what you'll notice is that every time it gets closer and closer to 1.618, dot, 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 dot. I mean, this is an irrational number, so it never ends. It's completely irrational, and that's why it's so important. But if you look at it like a spiral, every time it gets closer to 1.618, so it's getting this curvature, and it's like this line is like the law or the structure of the universe, and every time it gets higher and higher, these numbers, you see it's getting closer and closer to 1.618. Do you guys get that?
Yeah.
So it's like every time it expands, it's getting closer and closer to reaching perfection. But it will never get there because it's an irrational number and it goes on forever. But it just kind of shows you how life works, how it grows in these very specific patterns. And you can also, from 1.618, if you apply that to a circle, if you make a pie chart from that, you get 222 to 137.5. So that's 1.618 to 1. And if you look at nature, nature uses this to grow. So if you look at a plant from bird's eye view, the first one will be here. The first leaf that grows will grow like this. And then it will go 137.5 degrees, which is phi, so it's just all about phi, and then it will grow another leaf. And then it will do the same, and it will grow another leaf. And the way that it does this is it keep on going forever, and the leaves would never go on top of each other. So it's a sustainable thing. Like if you did it with normal mathematics, and you did a leaf here, then 90 degrees, another leaf, 90 degrees, 90 degrees, then the next leaf would go under the other one, so it wouldn't be able to get any sunlight. So this is a way that nature, the intelligence of nature has designed this, or followed this mathematics, so all the leaves get equal amount of sunlight. So this knowledge could also be applied to economics and to society, and we'd have a lot more fairness in society. So you can kind of see here again that the way it spirals up, and it uses the spiral of phi in order to grow. And you can see it here, like in the other picture we looked at, which I think we said was broccoli. It might be coral also, but I'm pretty sure that one's broccoli. Do you guys kind of understand that spiraling concept?
Yes.
And how it uses that to be fair, because nature is very fair. And all the plants should get equal light. So it's something that if you start looking at nature, you'll start noticing this mathematics is there. And it's just really amazing because it's everywhere. And this is a picture of like the galaxy. So looking out at all of the stars in the galaxy, and also is doing the same thing.
How are you getting all these pictures onto this?
No, most of these are pictures that I've got off the internet, but I just put them together in order to explain these things. But yeah, there's some cool stuff on the internet. If you search this type of stuff on the internet, it'll go forever. But this is quite cool as well. You can even see that the way, if you flick your hair, it'll also do this spiral. It's everywhere. It's like a part of physics and a part of gravity, and it's connected with everything.
But you can't see it.
You can see it. You can observe it. If you look at nature, you'll see it. And this is an also interesting. This is kind of another example of how everything is connected. So if you look at your brain, like this is from a picture taken from a CAT scan or something similar, and it's what your brain looks like, the cells in your brain, and this is what the universe looks like. So they're very similar. And what I'm trying to get across today is that everything is connected. And when you understand that, then life makes a lot of sense. So this is where you can see an art. Like all of these art pieces I'm going to show you next are very famous, and they all use fire. You can see that these lines are going to pop up, and then a frog. So again, we can look at our fingers, and we can understand this. But this shows us that it's in nature. All animals grow in accordance with fire. So you can see it on your ear, that there's that spiral there. If you look at your hand compared to here, this is 1, this is 1.618. So you can actually look at your hand and be like, if that is 1, that is 1.618. And then do it again here. And you can do it from your belly button. And when I got into this stuff, it just opened up a whole world for me. So you can also see it in the human face, the way our face is structured, and even beauty, what we call beauty, or physical beauty, is based on geometry. So you can see all this mathematics within the human face. And also, if you know the Mona Lisa, which is a famous painting by Leonardo da Vinci, he was very interested in this stuff. He was obsessed like me. So all his paintings, he was very specific, you know. He mapped it all out, and he put this geometry into it. So this is one called the Vitruvian Man. And so it's very common in the art world. And if you look at the Vitruvian Man, which is a very famous painting, you'll also find that it's got the ratios and the mathematics of the Earth compared to the Moon. So within his paintings, using sacred geometry, he would hide all of these amazing things. So you look at this circle in comparison with this, and that's the exact ratio and comparison between the Moon and the Earth. So this mathematics is universal. It'll help you understand the whole solar system. And these are just some more paintings. This is the Last Supper, which is a very significant painting by Leonardo da Vinci. And this is also, because he understood that all things are connected, within these paintings are also all these symbols. Like, you'll find that the 12 disciples in the Bible, they're broken up into 3. So there's 3 here, there's 3 here, there's 3 here, and there's 3 here. So that's 4 groups of 3, and that's what the seasons look like. If you look at the Earth and our seasons, you know, summer, winter, autumn, it's 4. There's the 4 parts, and within them, there are 3 sections. So this is a bit confusing with the flower there. But, you know, and Jesus was the symbol of the sun in this particular thing. Mm-hmm.
Is this all just mass that you can watch yourself
with us? This connects everything. So through this knowledge, you realize that astrology, mathematics, like the seasons, language, everything is connected. And this is just a way of understanding that and putting all the pieces of the puzzle together. So this is like the science that connects everything. And that's why it's so interesting, because, are the pictures important? What about that? Sorry. What about? Yeah. Well, he's dead now, but he was a very famous artist, and a lot of Leonardo da Vinci. But these are all different paintings by different artists. But like, I just kind of wanted to show you that within that, why they were famous is because they had this information in their paintings. So they weren't just paintings that they did randomly. They planned them all out, and they're so famous because they have all these secrets in them. And same with this is another really famous painting. And and it represents our connection with God or with the heavens. And if you look at the shape of God, and if you look at the fingers, first of all, actually I put that up the slide out, that's right. But yeah, you can again see that even the fingers, everything is painted so specifically. And again, same here, you see the spiral and all this. Like these paintings are very sophisticated, you know. They were mathematicians as well as artists. And you can see it with the Egyptians as well. What the Egyptians left behind was really amazing. And all of the things that they carved into stone was so full of geometry. So here's some, these are just all famous sculptures and paintings, and you can just see that all the mathematics are in there. So here's another example as well, and you can see the pentagram, which we've been over before, and they kind of, that it goes on forever. And you can see this mathematics. So if you look at the pentagram, you can see that this is 1 to 1.618. And this is 1 to 1.618. So all these beautiful patterns, just they have fire everywhere. And again, here's an architecture and all the buildings that they've built, all those churches and, yep.
They're the same buildings, aren't they?
Yeah, it's the same buildings. It's just, you can just see the different geometric lines in there. And again, here again, you can see in the chapels and the big churches, they have this Vesuvius, which we went over before, which was that shape there. So it's, they use it in architecture a lot. And this is the Taj Mahal.
Oh, my
building.
Yeah? My auntie and my cousin
went to the Taj Mahal. Yeah? Oh, it's cool, man. There's so many beautiful...
It's made of gold.
Yeah, it's I think it's a park gold. I don't know how much of it is. I've never been there. I've never been to India.
It's gold.
We'll get onto that later. Yeah.
I'm from India.
Oh yeah? Cool, man. I'm from Cyprus, if anyone knows where that's from. And from Greece. Huh?
Are you going to be like?
Oh, you can say that. And that's the Pantheon in Greece. So which is another famous old building, which again, they built using the same geometry. And these are mosques. So the Muslims, they even their buildings are so filled with geometry. And I just find it very interesting that all religions, they know about this. Whether or not they talk about it, it's in their religions and in their cultures. Yeah? It's on the roof, so if you're looking at this, you'd be standing in the middle looking up. So it's like, it's built into a dome, or as they call it, a cupola in architectural terms, but it's like a bowl, you know, it's the shape of a bowl, but they've put all this, you know, they've put a lot of work into making it.
How do you learn all this stuff?
From a lot of different sources. I can put you onto some good sources later, but I've just read so many books and I've met lots of people. I've travelled around the world a couple of times. I've been to many countries and I've talked to many people. Oh, I've never been to WA. That's still on my list, a very long list. So you can see that, like, when you look at the mosques and their geometry, it's the same as a pine cone. So this stuff is in nature. This is a building called... Yeah, it looks like it's called the Gherkin. It's a building in London, and again, it's just like, just looking at it, it's like, wow, like it's really, it's taking nature.
What's that? Is that actual?
So what? Sorry.
What's that?
That's the top of it.
That's the top of it. Yeah, that's looking at it if you were looking down on it from bird's eye view, and that's if you're looking at it from the side. No, it's just a building. I think it is something to do with the university. But I might be wrong there. I'm not 100% sure what they use the building for, but yep.
That little building,
it looks like what?
Disco balls.
It does, doesn't it? Yeah, even disco balls are using geometry. Anything that's using a circle. So this is another one. This is a place called Angkor Wat in Cambodia. I've been lucky enough to go see that in person. And again, like the pine, you can see how it's all based off natural geometry. The pine cone is always a really good example, because if you look at the pine cone from the top, it's just so beautiful. these are just more examples of cathedral windows and mosques and all these patterns. And you can also find the swastika in a lot of these ancient archetypes, which is a very sacred symbol before the Nazis used it. And in India, you'll find it in India everywhere as well, because they were using it before the Nazis, you know, Yeah, it is. It's like a maze kind of, eh? And you know Stonehenge? Have you heard of that place?
Yes!
So this Stonehenge has this geometry everywhere. And it's so important because it's all about tracking the sun. It's all about understanding the seasons. So when you use this geometry, you're using the same geometry that the sun uses and the earth uses and the relationship they have with one another. And the ancient people in the land of England and all the ancient people, they used to build all these structures that would show them, like this is a calendar. It's not just a building, it's a calendar, a giant calendar. So, and these are other pictures of Stonehenge, and you can see the geometry within it. So this stuff is all through Stonehenge. And it just kind of gives you an idea of how common it is. And you can also see it in the structures of the roads. And you can find that this geometry is put into everything, into all the city layouts. Yep.
Miss Duncan said there's no point going all around the world to make a map, to make a huge one of the whole world. There's no point to it because you can just get a small one.
Yeah. No comment. So we're just looking at the cities, and now you can see that in the pyramids, if you look at the pyramids from bird's eye view, you'll find the same thing, that all this mathematics is there. That's me when I went to Egypt the second time.
So,
yeah, I've been there twice now. I've been a lot of places in the world because I was obsessed with this stuff. I wanted to know more and more and more. And as soon as I left school, I started traveling so I could find out as much information as I could.
Did your mom and dad used to travel around the world?
Yeah, they did. My parents were travelers as well. They settled down when they had me, but they also took us traveling a lot. So if you look at the pyramids, the pyramids of Giza on the Giza Plateau, you'll find that they're perfectly in line with the stars. So this stuff is also connected to the stars in some way, and it's perfect. Like, these people built this a long time ago, and it's perfectly in line with the stars.
You know how you can get those necklaces from your things like cancer, you got cancer,
mm-hmm.
and then you got your stars?
Yeah, the star signs.
Me and my brother have one of them.
Yeah, those are also interesting as well. What I've found through my studies is that, like, If you understand the different signs of the zodiac, you can understand yourself a lot more as well.
I only remember cancer because
I'm not very good with them either. I'm still learning myself. I'm still a student, just like you guys. So this is another pyramid in Egypt called the Saqqara, which is one of the famous step pyramids. And you can just see that this is in line with the constellations as well, with Andromeda, which is part of the Pleiades, or close to the Pleiades. Yep.
What? Why do you have two of them?
Just because one looked empty on the page, so I thought I'd put two. So there's no reason. There's no real reason behind it. And here you can see, these are the three pyramids of Egypt, and they've got the photograph, and then they've put over the top the stars. So these are actual stars, and you can see how perfectly they position over the top of it.
Did you go
on
the top of them?
No, I didn't. You can't go to the top of them anymore.
Why?
Just because they don't want people to damage them, which seems stupid because they're made of rock, like solid granite. But also out of respect for them.
They don't hurt you, not us anymore.
Probably, but I didn't go to the top of the pyramids. They don't let you anymore. But you can also see here that, like, inside of the... This is the Great Pyramid, the biggest one in Giza. And inside of it, there's all these chambers. And this is the king's chamber, this is the queen's chamber. And you can see that they line up perfectly with star constellations, like perfectly, and it's really amazing.
How high is it?
The pyramid?
Yeah.
I'm not sure how high it is, but it's comprised of about, I think it's 2 million rocks to make it up.
Whoa.
They say that if they built the pyramids in 20 years, which is what they said they did, I don't know if it's true, then a block was placed every 2 minutes. And these blocks, some of them weighed up to 10,000 tons, and the cranes that we have today, the big cranes can only lift a fifth of that. They can only lift 200 tons. So we still don't know how they built them. I don't know. It's a mystery as far as, but it's very interesting because they
probably had to get 1,000 or 50,000 men.
Well, they couldn't even that couldn't do it. Like, however they built these, they were using, they had a lot of knowledge that we don't have, or we have lost in some way. Yeah?
Can you get inside the chambers?
You can still go inside the chambers in there. It's very weird, like it feels really weird when you're in there. There's so much energy in there. It's hard to explain or scientifically explain all that you can. But, yeah.
You know how you can't climb obstacles?
Yeah. Well, it depends on their legal knowledge. Because they would get in trouble with the... I don't even know if the state owns the pyramids now. I don't know what the legal setup is, but I don't know. I don't know that's the answer. Yeah.
Is it haunted?
I don't think so. I think haunted is a lack of understanding to me personally, but I don't know. Again, yeah?
You probably wouldn't get charged because you know about it.
Well, I know a lot about law, so my position within the world might be a little bit different to the next person, but we can't get into that now because it's a whole other topic. So these things are massive. They're, when you see them, it's like...
Is that smaller than you?
Huh?
Is that smaller than
you? Yeah, all way taller than me. Like they're, I'm just trying to think of all the dimensions of them. Like, it's slipping my mind right now. But I think they sprawl across 40 hectares. Does that sound about right?
Can you imagine taking like...
Yeah.
So, you know that biggest one?
Yeah.
So, like, if you were taking a picture of that, but you really couldn't because it's big, then
you'd have to go along like that.
A dot, like, there could be a dot and that could be you. But yeah. They wouldn't notice.
Yeah, you'd be tiny. Like, every one of these bricks that it's made of is bigger than us.
I thought that,
So they're really, really big.
I thought that small stone would be bigger than you. But it would
be bigger than it. Yeah, no, it's... They're really massive. And the pyramids are just something I wanted to touch on because they're just... They've amazed me for so long and no one could tell me about them, so I had to go find information for myself. Yeah? How many pyramids?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. There's a lot, though. There's actually some in South America as well. And there's some underwater near Japan. So the water has come up and they're underwater now. But these pyramids, they're very common around the world, but Egypt is most famous for them. Yeah?
Is this small pyramid bigger than this building?
Yeah, way bigger. I mean, from the picture we looked at before, the smallest one would have been a lot bigger than this. I wish I could tell you the height of them so you could realise, but hopefully some of you guys, get to see it if you decide to. Yeah?
Yeah, I'm going to go to the one of my brothers
is going to
travel around the world, so he can probably tell me.
I think so. It's the best thing I ever did was traveling. I learned so much about myself and about the world. So
it wouldn't really matter if no one told you because it's good to find out for yourself.
It is. And at the end of the day, like, you can read information. Sometimes I read a book and it will say one thing, and then I'll read another book and it will say another thing. So the more information you gather, the more understanding we have. So I always like to read two opposite views so I can understand the argument, because there's always an argument for like different views to everything. Yeah?
Can you break a pyramid open?
No, well, actually, when they went inside of the Great Pyramid of Giza, they used explosives to break it open. So they, because they wanted to know what was inside, they thought there was going to be gold inside. And they still teach today in some places that they're burial chambers, that the king was buried in there. And they did find a sarcophagus, which is like a tomb, in the king's chamber, but there was no one in it. And it was used for ceremonial purposes, not burial, because all the pharaohs were buried in the valley of the kings and the valley of the queens, which is probably it.
I thought like the bricks were like pretty small, but not like that big.
Well, there's a difference between them. Some of them are like, there's one in Baalbek, Lebanon, which is right next to Egypt, and that one's 10,000 tons. No, sorry, 1,000 tons. So that's the biggest block in the world, and they have no idea how these ancient people moved them, because they didn't have electricity according to mainstream history, so it's hard to imagine.
If you go on the pyramids and they make you stay in there, can you die?
I'm not sure. I mean, what do you mean by that? I don't quite understand the question. If someone locked you in there?
Yeah.
Well, I guess so. If you didn't have any water, you'd probably die. But, you know, that's a whole other subject because, I'm not even going to get into that. But, if you were locked in there, you'd probably die.
How long would the...
That's a disputable topic because some people say they've been there. Some people say that King Khufu built the biggest of the pyramids, a guy called King Khufu. But if you look at... Yeah, he's died. He was one of the pharaohs. Like, he was kind of prior to the Pharaoh dynasty. But I believe that the pyramids are at least 60,000 years old. 60,000 years. And they could even be older. Like, it's very hard to tell because it's hard to carbon date rock. But if you look at the Sphinx, do you guys know what the Sphinx is? It's like the lion's body with the man's head. That's covered in water erosion, which means that water has kind of eroded it. And there hasn't been significant rainfall in Egypt for like 10,500 years. So it's at least 10,500 years old, and that's fairly factual and scientific. Yep.
Have you seen any bodies in
the
pyramids?
Well, no, the pyramids weren't used as burial tombs. Like that's not true. That's a misconception. Because I've seen some of their, they used to mummify. They used to mummify people in Egypt. So that means that they would take all of their organs out with hooks and stuff, and then they would apply salts and different things like that to the body to preserve it. Then they'd wrap it, like mummies, Egyptian mummies. So the Egyptians had a lot of strange beliefs around death and preserving the body. I don't understand it all. You have to do your own research. Well, they were dead. They were still dead. But they just wanted their bodies, even though they were dead, for their bodies to be preserved.
But how are they still alive? They took brain parts.
But they're not alive. They're dead. It's part of their burial traditions. So when someone died, they would take all the organs out and then just wrap them up in...
Well, the question that...
It's pretty interesting. I'll tell you one thing about the pyramid, like pyramids as geometric structures. There were, after the Soviet Union and Russia, a lot of the scientists were studying pyramids for about 20 years because they were very interested in them. And they found that the thing that seeds grow faster inside of pyramids, and they also have more nutrients in them. They found that if you put like a meat product or something inside of a pyramid, it will naturally dehydrate. And if you put it in, if it's not in a pyramid, it will go off and get moldy. And the same with, if you put certain type of milk inside a pyramid will turn to yogurt. So there's a lot of mysterious things about pyramids and why they built them. But I'm going to move on a little bit. We can go back to that later if you want. But the pyramids also have, it's the one of the only structures in the world that has both pi and phi within it. So I don't know if you guys know what pi is, but we don't really have time to go into that now. But like, yeah, it's really amazing. And the pyramids are built in perfect proportion to the earth. So the pyramids are exactly the same proportions as the earth. Yep.
Can I
get a drink? Of course. Yeah, go get a drink. Yeah, so going back to phi and all this mathematics, you can find it everywhere. You can find it in art, you can find it in architecture, and also in music. So any of you who are familiar with music, and you know the Fibonacci sequence, which is 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, you'll find that these numbers are common in music. So to do a complete, to go through all the notes from E back to E is 13. And the scale is comprised of 8 notes. So it's also very common in music, this mathematics. And it's what created music, you know. Music can be described by geometry. Questions? Of course you can. Anyone else want to get a drink? Feel free to get a drink whenever you want to, I think.
No
right?
Way.
One at a time, I think. Did you have a question? So does anyone know what these are? Yeah? Kind of, but yeah.
Tablet?
Sorry?
Like a mat?
Kind of, but I'll tell you what they are. I don't even know exactly what they are, but all over the world they've found these strange patterns on fields. They're known as crop circles, and they just show up mysteriously. No one knows what they are, but they're like almost lasered into the grass. Like, so this is a very large, this is probably like about a kilometer. So they're giant mandalas or artwork that have just shown up mysteriously. And they also have this geometry in them. Yep.
You know when you said the science stuff, that looks exactly like it.
Yeah, it's everywhere. You'll start seeing it everywhere if you, like, you know, as soon as I got into the stuff, I just saw it everywhere. I wanted to know more and more. Yeah.
What made you, get into the stuff?
Do you know what? The first thing that actually got me into this was what happened on September the 11th. I don't know if you guys know about that. We probably shouldn't go into it. But something that happened politically, like something to do with war, got me into all this information. When I realized that some of the governments were lying to us, then I got into this information. But it was a very strange journey. Like it wouldn't make sense very much if I tried to explain step by step. Yeah.
Can I tell you that no one knows that?
Well, people know, but it's controversial. So like people think no one actually knows for sure. But yeah. Well, some people think so. A lot of people say that aliens made these because they can't explain them. It's like the pyramids. Like, no one can understand how they were built. So we can make up lots of crazy ideas, but at the end of the day, none of us really know. Well, I don't know. Yeah?
You know how you said something happens in the could we get into it?
Yeah. Well, we'll go through this and then I can advance it. We can go anywhere after we finish this, or even now. Like, I'm happy to talk about anything with you guys. I'm being as open as I can. Do you guys want? I can go into that if you would like.
Yes.
So, on September 11, 2001, like two planes hit two buildings in America, and they said that someone hijacked these planes. So it's actually like I'd have to probably talk for about 2 hours to talk about this, but the basic thing is two planes flew into two buildings, and the Americans said it was someone called Osama bin Laden, who used to you see, you probably don't know who George Bush is, any of the people involved. But it was very dodgy, and a lot of money was made, and after it happened, there was a lot of wars, and people went into other countries and started taking their resources and restructuring their political systems. And they all, and also in the country where it happened, in America, they also changed the laws so the police could have something under the, what's known as the Patriot Act. So they had a lot more rights, and the people had less rights, so that you could be searched randomly. Someone could come into your house whenever they wanted to without a permit. You could have your phone line like monitored by the CIA, so they could listen to conversations legally. So a lot of things happened on that day, and to me it was what the mainstream media was saying wasn't true. It was all But let's not get too much into that. I don't want to get your teacher in trouble for talking about. I wanted to try to keep this as mainstream as possible. But yeah.
That's that person who tried to crash that plane into lots of buildings and then.
Yeah, but one thing you have to understand, like we were saying before, like you can read information from one place and then you can read it somewhere else, and they'll tell a different story. And even the word history. It's etymologically comprised of two words, his and story. So when you say history, who's telling the history? It's his story. It's someone has told you that. So if you want to look at the history, you need to look at all these different people's perspectives. So history, so the same with that, you know, that was what they were saying, that Osama bin Laden did it, but again, like it's a very complex issue.
Is it kind of like when two people get into a fight and they
end up
with stories?
Absolutely. It's just like that. And geometry explains it. Like, so if I was standing here looking at this pattern, it would look completely different to what was here. So if I'm saying, oh, this is what it looks like from this perspective, and this would say, no, it looks like this. We're both right because we're looking at things from different angles. So you need to understand that there's so many different views in the world. And they're all right to a degree, they're all genuine perceptions.
Did anyone actually make that, or was it like they're...
They just popped up. All I know is that these just pop up all of a sudden, and they're so massive, like we would be like a tiny dot here. And so this is looking down on them, like from bird's eye view, from a helicopter, into these big like corn paddocks and... But what's interesting is like you look at this geometry and it's nature again. So these things that whatever reason these things have popped up, they're saying they're giving you information that ties back to this. Yep.
Because
there's a lot of information about that stuff. I don't get too much into it because I'll never know, you know. I like to work in areas where I can actually understand and I can relate, you know. All this I can relate back to me. Aliens, I don't have any idea. You start reading books and it's like, you know, sometimes it gets so crazy you don't know what's true anymore. So for me, I'm not too interested in aliens, but yeah, to me it seems silly to think that we're the only people in the whole universe. It just doesn't make any sense. And they have found other organisms on other planets, but you know whether or not. But no, they have found life, but like tiny things like insects, you know, like they have. So there is life on all other planets, or like pretty much every planet is life. Like every planet is living as well. Like the Earth is a living planet. It's a living being. And that's why it grows. And this is almost like the fingerprint of Mother Earth, of this planet, this geometry. Because it's like, same with us, you know. If you take one of your hairs, or a skin sample, or look in your eyes, they can find out like everything about you. Because it's your DNA, which we're going to get into quite soon.
What do you know?
Yeah, so if they take the DNA from any part of you, they can find out so much about you.
It's this,
They can find out so much, and we're going to get into that soon because genetics is extremely interesting. I'll answer a few more questions and I'll continue this, and then we'll just take it as it comes. Yep.
You must not watch TV that much
even the word alien, like I could say that if I didn't know what this was, I could say this was alien. Like you can use words like that. This is alien to me because I don't know what it is. So even to call something an alien is to say there's something out there and we don't know what it is. So like, you know, there's definitely aliens out there, but it's just they're beings that we don't understand yet. Same with the organisms that they found on Mars. They're alien to us because we still don't understand them. We could even say, you know, I'm alien to myself sometimes. I don't always understand myself, so sometimes I'm an alien. You know, in that sense of the word. Yep.
Why do we have to live on Earth and why can't we live on
I have no idea. Tell me when you figure that one out.
Okay.
Yep. Yep. They're called crop circles. That's what they're most commonly known as.
Could it
feel,
the world
on
oval?
Depends what size the oval was, but they're very big. Like some of these are bigger than the school field you have out there. The crop circles. So they're very big. Like, I haven't even seen your sporting facilities, but I guarantee they're bigger because it's very large. They're very large. Alright, so I'm going to pop back to this. Okay, one more question.
I know why we can't live on other planets.
It's, yeah, alright.
Because God made us live on one planet and we can't live on any other one.
Because all the other planets have...
I don't think that's entirely true. I can tell you why we can't live on there. It's because of our body. It's because we need oxygen.
Yeah, then why don't we just play through on the planet?
Well, it's also the soil conditions and... I'm sure you could make a lot, you could turn other planets into Earth if you had like astro permaculturists or something.
You could just take dirt and then you could just take some seeds and then just go into the
desert. Well, what they are doing, you know, deserts, which are just sand.
Yeah.
There's a subject called permaculture, which is what they do is they slowly turn that sand into like a rainforest. But they do it really slowly, so they'll plant something really small, like a fungus or a wild bush, and then create shelter and create like dampness, and then from that they'll grow a little bit more until they have a rainforest. So like, you can turn deserts into tropical paradises.
Oh.
And then it's a science and it's really amazing. Like, so yeah, so back to this one. So this geometry, this is called the torus. You know, we've been over this, but it's the same as an apple. So nature uses this geometry all the time, and you can see it here as well. So if you eat natural organic foods, they're closer to God, closer to nature, because they maintain this geometry. So if you eat synthesized foods like potato chips and chocolates and stuff, they're more processed and they're further away from this geometry. And if you have geometry inside of yourself, you know, you'll be happier. So geometry is also the measure of happiness and health. But you can see it here again on the monatomic level. And if we get this pattern, which we went over before, based on the seven circles, and we go from each of these points and create another circle, we get this type of pattern. So it's just... And that's called the flower of life. And you can also find this all around the world. Like some of these temples are in India, some of them in Ireland, and Scotland. So the ancient people knew a lot about this, but they don't know much about it now. So it's kind of funny. Yeah?
My brother lives in Ireland.
Does he? Oh, it's a beautiful place. Yeah? especially. Oh, there's so many places to see in this world. I encourage you kids when you can to start traveling. It's such a beautiful world out there. So this one's in China. You can see this is like a three-dimensional, like sphere of it. And it's this is in the Forbidden City of China. And this thing here is called the Fu Dog, and he's meant to be the guardian of wisdom. And you can see he's got his paw over this. So this is the wisdom they're talking about. This is the knowledge that he's guarding.
Fu Dog.
Yep. Yeah. There's a lot to see out there, isn't there? Alright. Do you have a question, sir? Alright, well, people. This is the oldest one they've found of this pattern, and it's in the Assyrian temple in Abydos, Egypt. And it's actually lasered into the stone. So, for example, if this was the stone here, if you chipped it away, if you cut this off, you'd still see the pattern. So it's through the whole rock. And they don't know how they did that either, I don't know. This is something from Leonardo da Vinci's notebook, because he was very interested in this. And if you... Okay, this is going to get pretty... I don't know if these slides are too much for you, like it's getting into chemistry. I don't know if we know about chemistry. So I'm going to go through them really quickly, and, you know... Okay. Yeah, so if you get the same pattern, and you do that, and you keep on expanding it, then you get something which is known the fruit of life, and it's comprised of 13 circles. And these 13 circles are also known as Metatron's cube. So this is Metatron's cube, and within Metatron's cube you can find 5 platonic solids, which are the building blocks of all life. And you can see here, and in sacred geometry, that the circles or the curves are considered feminine, and the lines are considered masculine. So these are all the masculine attributes here, and the circles are the feminine. Yeah. Who is? I don't mind. As long as the teacher doesn't mind, I don't mind. You guys. Oh, there's someone sitting in the wrong seat.
Oh, yeah, I'm just going to sit and watch it.
Is that cool?
I'm having a look too.
Alrighty. So within Metatron's cube, you can find all 5 of the platonic solids. Now, I don't expect you to know what platonic solids are, because most adults don't. But you can find the icosahedron, the dodecahedron, the octahedron, the hexahedron, star tetrahedron, and these are some very old ones that they found in Scotland. So they're at least 1,000 years old. So you know that 1,000 years ago they were familiar with this stuff. And so these are three-dimensional platonic solids. So platonic solids, they're polyhedral. Okay, let me break this down in easier terms. So with a platonic solid, each of their faces have to be exactly the same. So you can see that this is made up of pentagons or pentagonal faces. This is made up of like triangles, this is squares, and the cube is the best one to work with, because we all understand cubes a lot more than these ones. So a cube is made up of a whole bunch of squares, and they're all the exact same measurement. And the other thing that makes the platonic solid is every vertex has the same number of adjacent faces. So in other words, each of these from every angle has the same geometry. And there's only 5 of these in existence as far as they know. Like, they've made computers to try to figure out more of these, but these are the only ones that they know of. And they make up the building blocks of all life. All of these things. Yep. Platonic solids or sacred geometry in general. Yeah.
You know how you said it has everything in it?
Yeah.
It has
everything.
It does.
It is, it's amazing, yeah.
It shakes
and it also goes into chemistry, it goes into biology, because you'll find all the stuff inside of the human body, as well as in the stars and everywhere. So all of the elements on the periodic table, I don't know if you've got into this in science yet, but they all come from the platonic solids. And so all of these chemicals which make up all life are actually geometry. So it's very intriguing. And you'll find this geometry in the human body as well. So this chemistry, the geometry that you find inside of ourselves, is replicated. And some traditions believe that there are 7 key energy points in the body. And that's very interesting because there are also 7 colors in the rainbow. So, you know, this color spectrum is something that's everywhere. And you can also, so within the body they say that there is the red one here, and then it goes to orange on your solar plexus, orange on the sacral, then yellow, and it just goes through the whole body. The heart is said to be green. So a lot of traditions kind of, they connect this to your body. And it's also connected to notes, to the 7 primary notes in the musical scale, which become 8 if you do a complete cycle. And they all have their own frequency. Like, you can measure these, the frequencies in hertz, which again, we won't get too much into, but it's all geometry. And they're also 7 days of the week. So it comes back to sound. There's 7 notes, 7 colors, 7 days of the week, and it's really everywhere. And even if you look at the days of the week, like Monday was named after the moon, Moon Day. Sunday, after the sun. So all of these things go back to planets as well. Quickity click. So yeah, it's all within you. All the information in the whole universe is within your body. And sacred geometry is a way of understanding that. That these, like the torus, which we've been over before, and these energy fields, the electromagnetic, they're inside of you. So now I want to show you some work of a guy called Dr. Masaru Emoto, who's a Japanese scientist. And what he would do, he would collect water samples and put them in different environments. So he would get these water samples, and all the water was exactly the same. And some of them, he would have people yell at them like, you're ugly, you're horrible, you're bad. And then other ones, he would say to them, you're good, you're beautiful. And he would also put right things on them. And what this research determined, so this one, it had written on the test tubes, all these water were keeping in little glasses. And on the glass, he wrote Adolf Hitler, who, I don't know if you know who Hitler is, but he did a lot of bad things in this world. And what happened on a molecular level, when they looked at it with a little kind of microscope, is they found that it was just chaos. There was no structure. But when they wrote something like Mother Teresa on it, who did a lot of beautiful things in this world, it would form geometry. And same with this one. See, this one, they wrote on the test tube, love and appreciation, and it formed geometry. And this one, you make me sick, I want to kill you. No geometry. And the same here, like this is heavy metal music. And it didn't have as much geometry. Not saying heavy metal's bad, but it's just... it's just science. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it, but it's less... There's less structure to it. There's less geometry. And this one's thank you. Someone said thank you to this bit of water, and the actual particles in it changed. Now, what's most interesting about this... Like, your thoughts and your emotions affect things, and we're made of approximately 70% water. So if you think of us, we're made of water, so what we say to each other affects the geometry of our body, and that determines our happiness and our health. Did you want to ask something before I go on? No, the water doesn't make music. What they did is they got a glass of water, they got some water, and they put it in different places. So they might have put this in a room that was where there was music playing, and then they put it in another room, a different one, and there was different music, just to see the way that it affected the molecules of the water. And they might put one here, and she might be like, I don't like you, I hate you. And it wouldn't be good for the water. It would actually be less healthy for you as well. And then I might put it here, she might be like, I love you, you're so awesome. And this would be healthier, this water would be healthier, and that could be scientifically proven by the geometry of the molecules. So it leads you to realize that there's two primary emotions. There's love and there's fear. And those, and everything comes back down to them, like jealousy, anger, they come from a place of fear. And love and compassion, they come from a really good place, and it affects your DNA. Yep. Those are just people that I really love, like Mother Teresa, because I've read a lot of books about people that have done good in this world, so I can try to learn from them. That's Martin Luther King. He was involved in a lot of because if you look back in history, like blacks and whites used to be very separated, and they used to treat black people worse than white people, and he was all about changing that, because it's not fair, you know? We're all beautiful, we deserve... We are. We're all equal, and we all deserve to be treated the same. This is Mahatma Gandhi. Now, he was extremely interesting because he lived in at the same time where there was a lot of racism. He was in South Africa when he started getting into this, and he saw these black people being mistreated, and he was like, this is horrible, because he was black himself, but he grew up in England, and he was a lawyer, so he was considered to have quite a lot of status and considered a very respectable member of society. But then he went to another country and they were treating him like an animal. So he got very involved in this type of stuff, and he ended up doing so much good. Like he was very peaceful. So when he was trying to change things, he would never be violent. And often the police and the military, and they would be provoking violence, and he would just say, no violence, because violence doesn't do. He did a lot of good things. I think he changed this world. He did so much for this world, I think. I think all three of these people contributed to the good thing.
What about
Mother Teresa? I still need to do more research into her. I haven't read any books.
She was a lot to do with orphans and people who really needed help.
Yeah.
Like that, you know, in really poor countries, where she just helped people because she loved to do it. Yeah.
That's right. She was known for helping those that needed help. So instead of going out there and being like, I'm gonna get all the stuff for me, I'm gonna get a big house for me and a big car, she says, no, I'm gonna help people that need help. People without parents and people in poverty. And she lived a very humble lifestyle, meaning that she didn't have all these fancy things, but she was very happy. She was so happy because she could help other people. And that's because she was filled with love. And love is the most powerful force in the universe. Full stop. Questions?
Are they all dead?
They are, aren't they? They're all passed on, but they're still living through our memories. Like, you know, these people, what they've done in the world, it'll be remembered for hundreds of years. So I want to live a life like these people. I want to do really good in this world, because... Yeah, well, these are all... They're all taken from different periods of their life. I think Mother Teresa grew to be the oldest out of these three, but yeah. Don't be shy. I'll turn around so you can ask me the question. I'll let you, if you want to ask, or, that's okay. If you want to ask later, you can. I'll hang around for a little bit after if you want to ask me anything outside of class. Yep.
Can I get a drink?
Yes, you can get a drink. Remember the work of Masaru Emoto, though. Give thanks to, say thank you to the water. Good. I'm just stretching's good. What's your question? I'm not sure. I don't know how old they would be now. All I know is that they were living a life of love. Because this is what I'm talking about. These two things, fear and love. And you can break down all of your actions and all of your emotions to these two. Now, what's very interesting, do you guys know what DNA is?
No. Yes.
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 Well, I'll break it down for you basically, is that, like, if you look at your, like, your tissue in your body, it breaks down into organs and, like, and then those break down into cells, and then within the center of those cells is DNA. So your whole body is made up of DNA. It's like the Lego. So if you look at yourself as like a whole bunch of building blocks, like Lego, if the individual blocks are like DNA. So what they've found in the scientific world is when you, like, love is a very fast vibration. So you can also break everything down into vibration, because everything has like a wave to it, you know? And when you experience love, when you create love in yourself, it's very rapid, you know? Like when you're excited, you know how alive you feel? That also goes into your DNA. And within the DNA, so DNA is like a helix. And within these helixes are 24 codons. And these codons are like antennas. So they pick up on frequencies. They're like on mobile phones, you know, they pick up signals. So they react, when you have love, when you're experiencing love, you're waking them up. And when you experience fear, like, I don't know who has experienced depression or even just feeling sad, you know, it's like really heavy and not very stimulating. And it's, so when you're feeling fear, anything that comes from fear, it's very heavy on your body. And it's not stimulating your DNA. So the more love you experience, the more you evolve. So evolution is directly connected to love. So and DNA is just like, because we've all made of DNA, if your DNA is full of geometry, it means you're full of love. So, yep.
If you have like something wrong with you, if you had powers in your
body. Powers?
Yeah, wouldn't that
go through
the DNA to keep something going
forward?
Like something like an orange bubble?
Can you say that question again?
Like, if you had powers.
What do you mean by powers? Like
if you were weak and then you could go really strong, wouldn't that be in your DNA so you could see like part of your DNA?
It is. Well, do you know one thing? People talk about having like diseases that they're inherited. So your DNA changes every second. So this right here, it's not like it's solid. It's changing. All life is changing all the time. And it's changing based on your thoughts and your emotions, how you're feeling. Yeah?
The colors?
Well, this is just breaking it down into all the different particles. So there's 64 codons within it. And in our DNA, they're all different chemicals, and they have different chemical bonds that keep them in the structure they're in. And when you get into emotions, you realize that emotions actually change the chemical reactions in your body. Yeah? Of course you can. So yeah, I get it. So these are just... So there's 64 codons within these, and there's also in the I Ching, or the I Ching, which is like an Eastern philosophy, you'll find that there's these characters, 64 different characters, that they're all about telling the future, actually, and all about fortune. So this is directly connected to your DNA, and really it's... Like, you create your own future through your DNA, through programming. You program your DNA every second. So every time you say something bad about yourself, you're programming your DNA to believe that. So it's all about thinking positive and being positive. So this is an interesting as well. So what Dr. Cleve Baxter, what he did is he removed human DNA samples from a donor, from someone that gave their DNA, and then he put like another surveillance, like, so they had cameras and stuff watching this DNA, and what he found out was that the person that he took the DNA from, which was like 400 miles away, so the DNA was taken out of him, you know, just like a blood sample type of thing, And then what happened is when he was feeling an emotion, it would change over here. Even though they're 400 miles apart, what this guy was feeling was changing in the DNA that had been taken out of him. So your DNA is very connected, and it knows no space and time. There's no space and time in the world of DNA. Yeah. Oh, that's one of the paintings. I'm also an artist, so I did that painting.
Serious?
Yeah.
That looks cool.
Thank you. I appreciate that. It's of like the Buddha, which is one of the Eastern figures that a religion was built around.
Once you've done this, can you
do
a rap for us?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I don't know. When it comes to time, it's very hard to say because of history, you know? And because a lot of information gets destroyed over time. Like, I mean, our history only really goes back about 6,000 years to the Sumerians. They're the oldest civilization with written records. So beyond that, we actually don't know because no one left any writings behind. So all we know is based on what people remember and the stories that were told, and also through something known as channeling, which we're not going to get into because it's a bit heavy. So your DNA, this is the oldest symbol of medicine. Have you guys seen this symbol before?
Yeah.
Well, some of you have, and it's one of the oldest symbols of medicine. It's called the caduceus. This is where I get my stage name, which is Celestial Serpent, from this. And this is this. So this is a symbol of DNA. And it's also known as the Kundalini, which is like... The Kundalini is said to be the serpents that rise through your body. So the serpent is like it's a symbol of vibration, you know? Because the way snakes move is like this. And this is how vibrations work, you know? All of life, all known life, moves like this. In a frequency wave. Sound and light, they all travel like this. So when they say that the Kundalini or the snakes move through your body, they're just saying that energy moves through you. And if you want to be healthy, because this is a symbol of health, then you need to understand that your DNA and your emotions and your thoughts, you need to understand all these things. So DNA is very connected to health. It's the same thing. And what one's this? I think I'll skip this one. There's a few examples in here. But the way that your DNA works in your body, you know, because there's so many little strands of DNA or so many cells in your body, it kind of works like an orchestra. So you guys know what an orchestra is? It's a conductor at the front who's. And they play them together. So it only sounds good because they play together. And it's the same in your body. So if you're all your cells are operating properly and they're being conducted in an appropriate manner, then you'll experience health. So, and that's where we get the word conductor from, because a conductor is the person who controls the symphony or the orchestra. And that's also a word in electricity. Like a conductor is something that can move electricity. So if something's a conductor, electricity flows through it. So it's all about energy being able to move. And interestingly enough, the word disease comes from two words. So the opposite of health and happiness is disease. And disease is made of dis, meaning a negative, and ease. So ease means easy, everything's flowing, everything feels good. And if it's dis-ease, it's not flowing. So to be diseased is just not to have flow, not to have energy flowing through you. So that's why I like to think of this as an analogy of a conductor.
Yeah? How many slides
is this? I'm almost done. And then we can have a chat about whatever you guys want. Oh. So we're back at Egypt. Everyone loves Egypt. I was fascinated with this. I've actually got a song about Egypt, which I can show you at some point. Oh, is that the end?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's us then, isn't it? Yeah, alright. You guys are going to have to give me some subjects to rap about, and then I'll rap here about them. Yeah? So my topics for today that I'm going to be rusting about are fighting, music and dancing. Alright? So this is going to be a freestyle off the top of my head. Alright? Yeah, I don't want to see no more fighting, cause I'm all about dancing and uniting together as one. Get it down to the music, know that I'm ready to blow. I got the fuse lit, but I don't believe in violence. Don't want to fight, I want to feel this. Yo, I feel it in the night, in the music that I play. Whether it's an instrument or I just gotta say some words. And I like to bust some moves, I like dancing. You know it's just for food, so I like to get a little loose. You know I'm having fun and I emanate the truth. There we go. That's done.